Greetings to you all. We had been seeing about the kingdom of God from the Gospel of Matthew, the first or the fourth Gospels, from chapter 13. Because kingdom of God is one of the widely discussed and taught subject. Christ's ministry began with the kingdom of God and ended with the kingdom of God. Even after his resurrection, he spoke on the subject of kingdom of God almost for 40 days. So this is an essential subject, of which when I turned to the scripture, I found in the book of Matthew chapter 13, the whole chapter has been devoted to the kingdom of God, about which we had been seeing. And as first we saw the introduction to the kingdom of God, that is to say that we have other opposite kingdom, that is called the kingdom of the human adversary, that is the devil, or even we can say that it is a kingdom of darkness. Kingdom of God, kingdom of heaven, and kingdom of his dear son, or which is otherwise called the kingdom of light. So God, by his son's finished work, he has transferred all of us into the kingdom of his dear son. That is what exactly kingdom of God. So it is essential, positionally it has happened as far as God and Christ concerned. But how about you? Have you received that unto yourself? That's what it matters. So we are going to see as part 3, and that this will be the last one in this. So introduction and part 2 and part 3 we have handled, and today we are going to see, having talked about, he put a parable about the weeds. Weeds means we have seen the corruption. The kingdom of God at present is not without corruption within, but it will manifest gloriously one day without corruption. So he finished the parable with the weeds. Then now he is going to handle other parables, which is some precious things he is going to talk about. The parable of hidden treasures and a pearl of great value, and the parable of the net, and so on. And so we are going to see these three as part. So this is very important, precious one. So if you have not come into the kingdom of God, what I would suggest is, now is the time, because we are living in the end time, I believe, the first appearance of Jesus Christ, that is his first advent of the Lord Jesus Christ, was the beginning of last days. The end days he manifested, it says. So now in the end days, we have passed more than 2020 years. So now it is at most, almost we are coming to the end. So now is the time one has to think of coming into the kingdom of God without delay. Even I had been speaking to some people, they are very complacent about this world and the current situations they are not taking seriously. I don't know, maybe they are holding on to something as truth, but which is not truth in fact. Truth is something that is leading us, that gives us some knowledge and understanding of eternity past to eternity future. That you can have in only one place, which is the Word of God. The Word of God is Bible alone. No other scripture, no other text can give these details. So, short-lived people like us, short-lived mankind, at the maximum 80 years of life. After that, what? Death. After death, death is the threshold of entering into eternity. And eternity ends up in two places, either condemnation, which is hell, or a glorious future, which is heaven. That is what is kingdom of heaven or kingdom of God. So we shall see that today as part 3. Again, we will start with a little bit of introduction with two slides. So, Kingdom of Heaven, that is Paraloka Rajyam, we have been seeing. So, again, this is part 3. Gospel of Matthew, Basilia Theos, to Theos, that is Kingdom of God, and Basilia to Orano, Kingdom of Heaven. This is how Gospel of Matthew is dealing about Kingdom of Heaven or Kingdom of God, and which is 5 concepts of the Kingdom of God. How one Kingdom of God is in you presently, that is a present position, possession. Kingdom of God is a present possession, we have seen in the beatitude of chapter 5 of Matthew. And second one, approach through understanding, according to Mark chapter 12, 34. And third thing, it connects with rebirth. It is with the Jewish leader, that is Nicodemus, Dr. Nicodemus, and he was a blind concerning the truth. Then how much more all those who are following the idolatrous, having the idolatrous background. So it is through new birth we enter into the Kingdom of God. Then doing the will of God according to Matthew 7:25, and then we can inherit it by righteousness. Righteousness is nothing but, because there are various righteousness, self-righteousness, righteousness of the law, by them you cannot enter. But the righteousness according to God is a person who is Jesus the Christ, through whom you can enter. So now today's subject is the Kingdom of God. Jesus discussed with his disciples. தம்முடைய சீஷர்களுக்கு அவர் பேசுகிறார். From Matthew chapter 13, 36 to 53. So we are going to see 3 things in this. So let me read out 36. From 36 we can see. 36, there is a parable of the weed explained. And after that, up to 43, parable of weed means that is the corruption within. With that he finished. And then parable of the hidden treasure. He says, the Kingdom of Heaven is like a treasure hidden in the field, which a man found and covered up. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. So it's a hidden treasure in a field. So what do we understand by this? We will see that there are 3 parables he has spoken in this, 3 parables on outcomes of the Kingdom of God. So one was, it's the treasure, that is Matthew's treasure box. Okay, so what is the treasure? Treasure hidden in the field, which a man found and covered up, then in his joy he goes and sells it, sells all that he has and buy that field. This is the treasure was hidden in the field. Field is the world, and the hidden treasure, we will see what it is. And it is the one, he sells everything, that means he gives everything that belongs to him and buy that. Okay, so this is about the treasure. And so Kingdom of God is referred to a treasure that has been bought. We'll have to see the second one. And there is another parable, which is 13, 45 and 56. Again, the Kingdom of Heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls, who on finding one pearl of great value, went and sold all that he had and bought it. This is the one, 13, 45, 46. It is a pearl which is of great price. So he sold everything, great value, went and sold all that he had and bought it. And now there is a third thing, 3 parables. Third thing goes from 47 to 50. It is a dragnet. You know what is a dragnet? That is, you can see from the picture, fishing net. So the parable of the net, again, the Kingdom of Heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and gathered fish of every kind. When it was full, men drew it ashore and sat down and sorted the good into containers, but threw away the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the fiery furnace. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. So now here we have seen Jesus put forward to his apostles and the disciple the closer fellowship, three things. One is a treasure, we have seen. Second one is a pearl which is of great price, and that is, and third one is a dragnet, which is otherwise fishing net. Okay, so these three things has a meaning. If we see that one, the three parables which we see as outcome. First thing, what is that treasure? Treasure is the Israel. Treasure is referred to Israel. So the Lord, he found as a treasure, and he gave up everything and he came down. But the Israel, they rejected. Israel, they rejected their Lord. The Israel, they rejected their Lord. He gave up everything and came in a humble form. But they thought Christ will come as a king. No, he came as a son of man, and he was called the carpenter's son, and he humbled himself to the level of a slave so that he can die on the cross. This is what that parable denotes, the treasure which denotes the land of Israel, the entire land. And now it was dispersed across all over the world, and now the Israel has been brought back. He never let them down, because through them he brought the gospel to the whole world. So he has brought them back after almost 2000 years. The nation was not existent, and he has brought them back. This is the evidence. The people, those who reject the gospel, people, those who are holding on to other religious aspect, and they should leave that and come. The formation of the land of Israel itself is a miracle. Today it is existing. In 1948, May 14th, it was declared a nation. That itself is a miracle. So people are not accepting that now is the end time. Even most of the churches, they are very complacent about what is going on, going around the world at this time. They are not thinking of the end time. They think still they can get along as church and most of the Christians. So God did not form Christianity, religion, but God is interested in his son. That is why twice he said, "Behold my beloved son in whom I am well pleased," at the point of baptism when John baptized and declared Jesus Christ as, "Behold the Lamb of God which taketh away the sin of the world." He came for the entire world, but he was born in Israel. And again, together with Peter, the apostle, they misunderstood Jesus. They compared Jesus with Moses and prophet Elijah, and Jesus, a cloud overshadowed, and both the law and the prophet was hidden, Moses and Elijah. Only Jesus was left out. And a voice came from heaven, said, "Behold my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. Listen to him, give heed to him." So he gave all that belonged to him and came down to rescue us, to redeem us. But still people are very complacent. They are not accepting it. Now the second is, there is a pearl which is of great value, which I read already. A pearl which is of great value. Jesus is comparing again, the kingdom of heaven is a merchant in search of a pearls, but he find one pearl of great value. That is the church. We have to found. Church is nothing but the product of the finished work of Jesus Christ. Church belongs to, fully belongs to Him. And Jesus Christ is the head of the church. And in Matthew 16, He said, I will build my church upon this foundation. Foundation is nothing but the confession what Peter made. So He is the builder, He is the foundation. And Colossians, we see Jesus Christ is the head of the house of God. So He is all and in all. Now, I don't know how many people are holding on to, focusing, or have fixed their eyes on Jesus Christ. So this purchase, Acts 12:28, it clearly says, Acts 12:28, I'll read out 20 and 28. It says, pay careful attention to yourself and to all the flock that is in which the Holy Spirit has made you overseas, to care for the church of God which God obtained with His own blood. That means Jesus Christ shed blood and He obtained for Himself. So He is the blood bought is the church of God. And the fourth one, third one, what we could see is the Gentiles. That is what it says, the dragnet. He was talking about, we have seen about the dragnet. The third precious one is the dragnet, parable of the net. And again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and gathered the fish of every kind. So let us see. See, this is a dragnet. Heaven, kingdom of heaven is a dragnet thrown into the sea. That is, it is not it. Of course, it is thrown into the sea. That refers, sea refers the population, people of the whole world, okay, of every kind. The Bible explicitly says God is no respecter of person. He does not. He chose Israel, but He loves them. But He chose Israel for our sake. And He chose Abraham. Through Abraham, He wanted to save all the people of the world. So no one is excluded from the blessings in God's sight. So it was thrown into the multitude of the population and gathered every kind of fish. God made apostles the fishers of men. So every kind, God has no disparity. He wants every single soul. He matters. The soul that matters, because flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. That has to be translated, or that will be glorified, given a glorified body. And only the soul that counts. There is no black and white. There is no brown and yellow. Everyone is same. No linguistic difference. All God knows. God created one man, and from him He brought out the entire mankind. So we are a race. So this is a dragnet. When it was full, see, there is a fullness of time of the Gentile. There is in the Roman, the book of Romans, you can read, there is a fullness of time which has already arrived. That is why we see the sort of COVID-19 and mysterious curtain which is hanging between the Satan and the world government and the world religion. And people are not understanding, taking it to the heart. When it was full, men drew it ashore and sat down and sorted the good into containers, but threw away the bad. That means there is a hell and there is a heaven. That is why kingdom of God and there is a hell. People, those who reject, or the bad one, will be thrown into the hell fire. So we cannot take it light. This is a parable. And throw them into the fiery furnace. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. So God does not want any soul to perish, because hell was not created for mankind. It was created for devil and his angels. So it is in the dragnet is otherwise, that is the gospel or the good news. That is also a mystery. Good news in the New Testament is a mystery. That is the gospel proclamation which goes. That is the dragnet to all the Gentile people, even including Israel. The Bible divides exactly. If you see, we will see in the next slide, but the Bible divides the whole entire population into only three classes. We will see now. The dragnet I have given there. So now three divisions of people. So we cannot put anyone to stumble rather than preaching the gospel. So there are three classes. One is Jew, another one that is 10:32 and in Tamil 33, then Gentiles, and third one is the body of Christ. Okay, in 1 Corinthians 10:33. Let me read out from that. 1 Corinthians 10, Paul is writing very clearly, giving that, give no offense, 10:32, give no offense to Jews or to the Greek. Greek means it is a Gentile government, it says. In Tamil, if you read, it will be Pura Jadigal. Okay, the whole world except Israelite, rest of the all the countries and all the religion, they are together called as Greeks or to the Church of God. So there are three classes. The present world contain only three classes of people scripturally. One is Jews, the land of Israel. Second one's Greeks, the entire world population. Third one is the Church of God. Church of God is contains Jew and Gentile together. That's what the body of Christ. Church is only one. We have multitude of church, the multitudinous of church, which is there are a lot of corruption under which, but in the body of Christ there is no corruption, because in that body of Christ the head is Lord Jesus Christ. He is building that. No one can add anyone into that body of Christ. If you are truly saved, if Jesus Christ is your Savior, if He has saved you, then you are in the body of Christ. That is what is once saved, all saved. Some people say that is a wrong doctrine. If a sinner encounter Jesus Christ or the Savior and He saved the sinner, then He will not let him down. So that is what exactly the salvation. Salvation is by the Savior, one Savior who is Jesus the Christ. So at present the world comprises of Jew, Gentile and the body of Christ, and the body, one church, the body of Christ comprises of Jew and Gentiles of any language. That is, God is no respecter of person. There is no linguistic difference, and there is no caste difference, there is no color difference, nothing in that. So just see, imagine how the heaven will be, the kingdom of heaven shall be. So let us see. I have read already, give no offense to Jews or to Greeks or to the Church of God. Greek is referred to Gentile people. Just as I try to please everyone in everything I do, not seeking my own advantage but that of many, that they may be saved. So just for the sake of salvation, we should love, we should not put obstacles or hindrance on the way of anybody. Let us love everyone, give the gospel, which is the dragnet, which we have seen earlier slide, and that dragnet is thrown into the world, and we are dragging, and there is a judgment also would come. So we have seen there is a hell and there is a heaven. It is your choice to choose. You are a person who has been given free will, and you have a mind to think, and you have a free will, and you can act. So by thought, purpose and action, that's what exactly a soul or a personality. Today we see a lot of people, they go for personality development, but they do not know what exactly a personality. But Bible treat it very clearly. Your personality is by thought, reasoning together, and accordingly you will take a decision or you will purpose. And how you purpose, thus you will act. In the case of Daniel, you can see Daniel, he does not want to defile him with the kingly food. So he thought it will defile him. So that is what he thought, reasoned together. Then he decided not to have it. He just declared and he kept himself away from that. That is thought, purpose and action. Save your soul from the coming judgment. And the Christ is returning soon. And the great evidence is COVID-19. At the back end, what is going on? And the scripture very clearly tells us, based on the time we are living in. So if you understand, that is better for you. And now we can see truth and us. That is, there are, see the scribe, they scribe, the duty of the scribe is to discover. And the disciple and the steward, there are three classes of people. So they discover and they preach and they do sailbado. This is the truth. And the other slide, if you see the editions of truth in this and the previous slide goes together. There is a true liberty in knowing these three editions. You see, Word of God and the Spirit of God and Christ. There are three editions of truth. One is the Word of God. John 17:17 says, Thy word is the truth, and sanctify them by the truth. There it says, the word of God is only one, Bible. There is no other word of God under the heaven and above the earth. John 16:13 also says, that is, the Spirit of God is the truth, edition of truth. And third one is 14:6. Jesus very clearly says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one come to the Father except through me, and no one come to the heaven except through me. So the heaven's gate is defaulted, and the default gate name is Jesus the Christ. So the second truth, the Spirit of truth, gave us the Word of God, which is the truth, and the Word of God brings the Word of God, which is the truth, that is Jesus Christ himself. Okay, which is it complements each other. You see, Spirit of God gave us the Word of God, and the Word of God brings forth the Word, which is Jesus the Christ. And that Word became flesh. That is why the Bible says, if you know the Word of God, you will have a freedom. And if the Son sets you free, indeed you shall free. Where the Spirit of God, there is freedom, there is true liberty. So in these three, we have a threefold freedom through the three editions of truth. It is essential for us, if anyone who want to serve the Lord, they should know these three editions of truth, and their conscience or the inner man, inner heart must be filled with these three editions of truth appropriately. Holding these three appropriately in your conscience is the way to serve the Lord or serve in the kingdom of God. And now we go to Proverbs 23:23. Buy truth and do not sell it. Buy wisdom, instruction and understanding. Satyathai vangu adai virkadai. Today we see there are a lot of corruption within the kingdom of God, which we have seen in part 2 yesterday. So you can see that if you want, and even in the introduction I have given the first one, the 3 days one, the first one I have given in an introduction. There are a lot of evil which is prevailing within the kingdom of God, which will be eliminated at his arrival. So Proverbs also say, buy truth. Men of God should buy truth, not to sell it, to make money out of it. Today we see Jesus Christ is made a thing of merchandise. So make money out of, no, that is not the way of ministering the people. Freely ye receive and freely ye give. God has decided to take care of you. Let me tell you this for your sake. See, the Levitical priesthood, they don't have any property of their own. That is why the nation Israel was asked to tithe. So the tithe is basically for the Levitical priesthood. When there was no tithing, they ran away. So the temple was forgotten. That is why Jesus Christ writes in Malachi, okay, you bring your tithes. Actually, in fact, every Israelite has to bring three forms of tithe. That is why there it mentioned, bring your tithes. In the plural sense, it is stated there. So that is the study about tithe. I am not interested in it. But today, the tithe, give tithe, is being basically handled as a modified form of greed by most of the people today. I doubt they are serving the kingdom of God. They are not serving the kingdom of God, but they are serving some other kingdom. At least now, still you have time to change it. Repent. Now people, they have made wealth enormously. Recently I heard a man who is of old, very old. He is trying to build a church for 100 crores and 200 crores and 300 crores there. We are already at the end of the age. Why we should? The souls must be won. That is why the kingdom of God is like a dragnet. Throw, give the gospel to let it reach end to end, one end to another end. Let people come into the kingdom of God. That is why the kingdom of God is referred to a dragnet, not to make money out of it. Rather, God takes control of it. God will take care of you when we freely handle this, the kingdom truth. So another one, Acts 14:22, strengthening the souls of the disciples, encourage them to continue in the faith, and saying that so through many tribulation we must enter the kingdom of God. Kingdom of God, as we have seen, it is a pearl. That is, we have seen a pearl which is of great worth. That is why Jesus, he found it a great worth, the body of Christ. So he gave himself, but still to enter into the kingdom of God, to become great worth, that is the kingdom of God, we may have to go under through many tribulations. But don't worry, if you go, the very tribulation itself is the manifest evidence that you belong to the kingdom of God. Can I read you one verse from the book of 2 Thessalonians 1:5? It very clearly says, see, this is the evidence. This is the evidence, or it says this is a manifest evidence and righteous judgment of God, that you may be considered worthy of the kingdom of God, for which you are also suffering. See, Acts it says, if you suffer for the sake of kingdom of God, do not worry. That is the certificate issued to you, manifest evidence that you belong to the kingdom of God. That gives you an assurance. So rest assured, be assured that if you suffer for kingdom's sake, and you are assured of that. Okay. Now, abiding things, there are three. One is the love, second faith, and hope. Why I give this one here is, we are at the end time. These are the evidence. Now we can see. 13:13, what does it say? Let me read out. So now, see, this is a the entire chapter talks about love. Usually people point out to the people from the pulpit. I have seen many ministers and pastors pointing out others, but this chapter talks about the love of Christ primarily. Primarily this talks about the love of Christ, agape love. Love is of three classes. First is agape, second one is the filial love. Filial love is the one which we should have within the church. But the agape love is poured into our heart at the point of justification, salvation. It is not poured in a different way. When you are truly justified by the heaven's court, Father, Son and the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit is poured into our heart. In that, the agape love comes into you together with the peace of God. So this particular one, it talks about the love of Christ, agape love. At the end he says 13:13, so now faith, hope and love abide, these three, but the greatest of these is the love. Because faith is the present, hope is the future, faith is everlasting. Once you inherit the hope, you don't require any more faith. But one thing in this, the two things would be, so that is the evidence that we are living at the end of the age. Bible explicitly says, people will wax cold in love. Anbu tanindu pohum. He is not talking about the love in the worldly sense, love within the world, but he talks about the love within the kingdom. That is why I have added here. The love will wax cold. We can see within the body of Christ, there is no existing love, one against another. They freely tell lies. They scheme against others. They want to throw others away through lies and scheming and in many other way. But that is not the way. This is one of the causative factor for the love to diminish. That means such people have no agape love. Agape love will forbear all those things, and finally it will set aside. What we can do? We cannot correct somebody else if they are very firm and stern in continuing in their old way. So the love will wax cold, and that is one of the evidence of the end time. So now that evidence, and also faith, also it says Jesus, when he comes, will he find faith? People falling away from faith. It also says, in Tamil it says, Viswasa Throham. That is what it is called. Falling away from faith would occur. And also when Christ comes, will he find faith on this earth? Yes, within his people. So you need to be very careful. Maintain your love. That is what I read, that we cannot put stumbling block to Jews, Gentile, and to the body of Christ. So we have to love equally. Let them put stumbling block, but if you are a child of God, don't put stumbling block. Just keep yourself away from them, and also faith. Do not forsake the faith. Why I am telling, if you say Hebrew 13:2, it says it's not the agape love, but it is, see, it says, do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for thereby some have entertained another. Hospitality, which shows the brotherly love. And in the first word, let brotherly love continue, 13:1. Let brotherly love continue, Hebrew 13. In also Roman 12:10, 1 Thessalonians 4:9, 1 Peter, Roman 12:10, love one another with brotherly affection. In Romans, and also it says 1 Thessalonians 4:9. Now concerning brotherly love, you have, that is a filial love. Okay, it's not an agape love. 1 Peter also says, having purified your souls by your obedience to the truth for a sincere brotherly love, that is a filial love, which is talking about, and it goes on in so many references are there. So we have to have a brotherly love. Into our spirit, the agape love is poured by the Spirit of God, because the Spirit communicate with our spirit, according to Romans 8:15 and 16. The Spirit of God commune with your spirit. The Spirit of God commune with your spirit. That is why he poured the agape love into our spirit, and that agape love permeate through your conscience, mind, will, and emotion, and then the filial love. If we can, I'll just come out with a PowerPoint on that, God willing, and if his coming tarries. So then if these two goes, then there will be no hope of the kingdom of God. So the abiding things, we need to be very careful. Though 13 it expresses, teaches about Christ's love, and we need to be very careful about the love that is poured into our heart. And the faith also is a noun. It is not believing. Believing is the verb. So faith also, the author of the faith is Christ Jesus. So we should not go down in that faith. Faith, believing, and seeing. This also has three aspects of it, like exactly like love. So let us be careful. This is the kingdom principle which should continue to operate, and which should not, we should not cool down on this. We should be always fervent in these three things. And Psalm 1 also says, scripture, we have to delight. 1:2 it says, the verse 1:1 says, it talks about three folks and their three ways and our three actions, which I have already, that is, I call it as a negative holiness. Now is not the time. Psalm 1 talks about that delighting. Our delighting should be in the scripture in which we meditate. See, scripture, and then according to the meditation, a child of God, first he delights in the word of God and he meditates. Meditate is not the first level. First level is hearing, then reading for yourself, then studying and meditation. There are different levels of scripture and relationship with a particular believer. So meditation is very important. Meditation is otherwise called the chewing the gut. We are at the end time. So I encourage you to delight in the word of God and meditate on it. And so if you meditate, and you will do accordingly, and you will stay blessed. So Psalm 1 talks about the wicked and the righteous, or the righteous and the unrighteous. Unrighteous has no part in the kingdom of God. That is why I have given. So this is part of the kingdom of God. People need to exercise in their daily life, and it should be their routine. Okay. So now with this, I conclude the part 3 of the kingdom of God. So I wish you stay blessed. So may God bless you, and you keep waiting for the coming of the Lord, because we are living at the end time. As I am closing here, I would encourage you to study more about the kingdom of God, because gospel, Jesus began with the kingdom of God. And after his resurrection, 40 days he taught his closest allies about the kingdom of God before he was taken back to heaven, before he ascended into heaven. So the kingdom of heaven is a very important subject. I covered over 3 parts, but this is inexhaustive touching the kingdom of God. And I have given the kingdom of God definition. The definition was given in Rome by Paul. The kingdom of God is not eating and drinking, or it is not touching our flesh and blood, touching the body, but of the inner man, which is our soul. So that's why it says it is the righteousness, joy, and peace in the Holy Ghost. Let the righteousness, joy, and peace in the Spirit of God be yours forever. I'm wishing you well. Stay blessed. You can see that in my YouTube channel, and also it will be available on the Facebook, part 1, part 2, and part 3. So you can review that and see that. Stay blessed. You can pass it on to others. And I encourage you, you'll come into the kingdom of God. It is kept open for everyone. There is no linguistic difference. There is no color difference. There is no national barrier. And there is nothing. So the kingdom of God is open to everyone. The invitation is given to you. So if you receive Jesus Christ, you receive eternal life. And you become a child of God. You become a subject of the kingdom of God, or kingdom of heaven, or kingdom of his dear son Jesus Christ, which is also the kingdom of light. Okay. So positionally, God has done, because Jesus has finished the work once and for all. So it is a positional truth. God has already transferred. So now it is your choice to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. It is in your hand. By thought, purpose, and action, give yourself to Jesus Christ and receive him as your Savior, Redeemer, and Lord. And you start worshiping him. Keep waiting for his return in mid-heaven. Stay blessed. I wish you well. And stay blessed and stay safe during this period. May God protect you. May God build you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.